leadership instills in people a hope of success and belief in themselves. If your actions inspire others to dream more, to learn more, to do more, and to become more, then you are a leader. Hello friends, today we are standing outside one of the famous IT hubs in Gurugram, and we are here to meet our first leader for the very first episode of Leadership Talks. We have been waiting this day since long. Even our teammates have been working hard for it. So, here we are. But wait, this journey will be incomplete without your support and motivation. So friends, keep on motivating us to do such things, because each day is a learning day. So here is the moment, guys, when we are at one.com India, where we shall be interacting and asking some interesting questions to our guest of honor to carve out some secret mantras for success. So here we go.
Let's know who is our leader for episode 1. Mr. Alok Tiwari has a vast experience of 27 years in the industry. Worked earlier in Infosys Technologies Limited, Pune, for almost 12 years. And now he's with one.com since 2012 and is currently the country head and director here. His expertise is corporate strategy, technology, design and execution frameworks, business process optimization, infrastructure management, business management, human capital management, compliances, etc. He has done design thinking in innovation of products and services from Massachusetts Institute of Technology to Sloan School of Management. He has various publications in the areas like design models and development strategy, developing effective online assessment system, distributed web conferencing architecture, digital learning, etc. He has received Infosys Excellence Award in the year 2002, 3, 5, 7, 8, 10, and in 2011 by the Board of Directors. This can go on and on. So we cut short the introduction part and here we go. As our audience must be aware that episode 1 focuses on resilience, one of the most important traits that any leader must possess to succeed in any sector. What is resilience? Resilience is a mental, physical, emotional and behavioral ability to face and cope with adversity, adapt to change, recover, learn and grow from setbacks that one may encounter. As Margaret has rightly said, you may have to fight a battle more than once to win it. Also, Dieter has mentioned, it's your reaction to adversity and not adversity itself that determines how one's life story will develop. Not taking much of the time now, let's say hello to our guest of honor for today, Mr. Alok Tiwari.
First of all, thank you so much, sir, for inviting us here. Shall we start the session, sir?
Sure.
All right. So your first question is, you're known as an epitome of calmness in this industry. Please share the secrets with our young students listening to you and how they can adopt this kind of calmness even in the toughest situations they face.
Okay. So usually when I relate calmness, it basically means multiple things, right? So it's how calm you are from inside, how calm you look from outside, and how do really people perceive you as calm or not so calm.
Yeah.
So I believe as a human being, everyone basically has emotions which could basically bring calmness, which could bring anger, which could basically could be reactive, could be responsive and stuff like that. But I think what's more important is that we respond and not react to the situation. Many a times I think it's quite natural that when people come to different situations and sometimes they're complex situation, they react instead of responding. So if we keep a focus on responding to the situation, then you will be thoughtful, you will be watchful, you will take some time and you will probably take your own understanding about the situation and then try to solve it, as against a situation lands to you and then you react to the situation, which definitely takes you away, far away from the calmness. So in my sense, it's extremely important that people have both. But then what is more important is they look calm from outside, because inside there could be a lot of tussle going on. Inside there could be a lot of decision making going on. Inside you could really be thinking, how should you be responding? Should you be reacting? Should you be doing something else and stuff like that? But I think it's very important that as a personality, one individually is being looked at very, very calm from outside, because that's what basically is what people see you as.
Hey guys, this is the trait everyone needs to adopt in their personality to succeed in any profession. Shall we move on to the next question, sir?
Sure.
As a company, what are three major skills other than hard technical skills you look for in the prospective candidate before hiring him or her?
Okay, so you already cut down the major requirements, which are actually the technical skills and the behavioral skills, which usually people have. But I guess based on my experience, I can say the first and foremost assessment which we do for any potential candidate for one.com is that person has to be a good human being. According to me, I believe we all are Homo sapiens, and unless and until we have the traits of one, it's very difficult and very, very impossible to really hire somebody who is not really having those good traits. So first check is that we find and identify that the person is good human being, right? Now, what are the qualities of being a good human being? A good human being is, first of all, a human being, right?
Yeah.
And then at the same time, he is compassionate. He or she is more honest, of course, right? Has integral values, has a culture which basically defines the person, the character which defines the person. Is governed by the value system which is being taught to that individual, maybe by the family or maybe by some other company, right? And I think this put together really is a good benchmark and a good assessment for anyone beyond the technical skills or beyond the behavioral skills to judge that a person is going to be a good fit or not. I think any organization would like to have people who are good. Any organization would like to have people who can work humanly. Any organization would like to have people who can not only just work but also compassionate to each other. Any organization would also like to have people who are conscious about the social responsibilities they have, right? And I think if we start aiming and start focusing on these traits of people as intake mechanism for the companies, then I believe the world will change. And world will rather become a very different world. Then you will find very different traits outside as well. So for example, in our nation, we are being taught in the schools that we should be in queue, right? How many times we really are in queue when we go outside, when we grow up, maybe for a metro or maybe for any other line, right? We try to break that. We try to, of course, go forward, right? Now, how does it relate to being good or bad? I think it relates to how much we care about others. The point is that if I just keep thinking about that I need to be faster, I'm also realizing that I'm actually going ahead of someone else. And maybe that person needs to be there in that queue more than me, and maybe he has come at the right time, etc. So I believe there are a lot of examples like metro. You have seats being reserved for certain class of people, right? A typical trait of a good human being is that's being respected, right? There are a lot of crimes which we see in our country and around the world, right? I think if we have good human beings, then they will be more cautious, they will be more nurtured, they will be, of course, be more compassionate, they will understand that these crimes are basically doing good for no one, right? So I think in nutshell, I will say that it's important for any organization to have the right technical skills, right behavioral skills, but it's even more important that they actually hire people who are good human beings.
Students should keep these brownie points in mind to become a good human being, and it will automatically improve your professional life. Moving forward to the next question, sir.
Sure.
In this pandemic situation globally, do you think that your company could see it is an opportunity?
I guess yes. I mean, so most of the time when we see situations like these, you tend to believe that it's going to impact the business in a very adverse manner, or it will probably create a lot of problem for the economy and stuff like that. For some of the sectors and some of the businesses, it does impact, no doubt. And for some of the businesses, it really becomes a great opportunity to encash on. I'm of the strong opinion that these are the situations which actually ensures people think different, people innovate, and of course there are new ways of doing things. And many times this becomes a disruption, this becomes a wave of disruption, this becomes a new model of doing businesses, etc. in the situations like these. But it definitely does impact some of the businesses for sure, who are not able to, of course, adapt that quickly. And sometimes the model of businesses are so hardwired, it's very difficult to change in such a short span of time and generate the difference in the market. But fortunately for us, since we are into a setup which basically allows people to come online, we are into a setup which basically allow people to have their web shops online. We are in the setup which basically allows companies or small or medium or business, large businesses basically to have their digital presence. It basically helps us because at this point of time, a lot of people, a lot of companies are actually thinking of selling their materials or selling their stuff or telling the world what they do, how they do, etc., all using online presence. And since we are into a business which basically allows people to come online, with the help of domains and with the help of various tools which allows them to make simple, fast, fair websites, I think it becomes much more opportunistic for us in order to encash on this opportunity. Coming back to the area which we belong to, the geography we belong to. So, I mean, in India, we have roughly around 900 million internet users. It's more than the population of US. So half of the population of the world is right now basically is consuming internet some way or the other. You basically have crossed 2 zettabytes of data traffic, in fact, in 2020. So I think every company is now becoming, in some sense, an information technology company, irrespective of what they're actually doing. They could be a textile company, they could be a manufacturing company, but behind the scene, there is a lot of information technology which is getting used for them to be very, very effective. And gone are the days where, probably due to pandemics, gone are the days when the solutions were sold face to face, when the solutions were being marketed, in fact, face to face. I think most of the world is going online, and that's creating a lot of difference. So, as an example, imagine the clothes we wear, right? Most of the time before pandemic, we would have gone to the shopping floors, we would have gone to the malls, and we would have rather tried them on us. We would have seen, this is looking nice, this is the right fit, this is the right size, and stuff like that, right? And the moment we choose, then we of course buy, and then we are happy that we have bought the right stuff, right? There was a technology, and there is a technology even today, which probably doesn't allow people, or does not, people don't have to really go to the malls for that. I mean, they can virtually try to see how those clothes will fit in, the sizes are right or not, the colors will look nice on them or not, and they can just buy online, right? There are lots of advertisements we see around for spectacles. People can try, right? And they don't have to go really to the shop to buy that, right? So I think all this requires people to come online, first of all this require people to start selling online, and for that they need to have a domain, for that they need to of course have some of the tools which helps them build their website, and that also help them basically to sell online in different markets, not just the local geography but also across the world. So since we are into the business which makes people come online, we are into the business which generates the digital presence, we are the dot companion for the world, it really helps us in this situation to of course encash and utilize this opportunity. But to be honest, it also generates a feeling somewhere that it's not a good time for a lot of people in the world, and we should not be very proud about the fact that we are making money because of this situation. I think we need to make money because we are good, and irrespective of any situation we are into.
Absolutely, sir. Every coin has two sides. It's up to us how we take it as.
Sure.
Whether an opportunity or just an excuse.
Absolutely.
Shall we proceed, sir?
Sure.
Okay. Over a period of time, with so many modern technologies and methods of working coming in, what do you think is the one thing you would like to bring back?
Okay. So, to be honest, nothing. The reason is that most of the time when we try to be in our present, or when we try to see what we are working on or how we are working on, I think it is contextual to the present situation. So for example, we are right now dealing with COVID, right? Tomorrow there could be something else, positive, negative, right? Past, there were different situations, different perceptions, different context. The world was moving at a different race, probably a rat race, for achieving something, for finding something, for generating something, for doing differently, right? So most of the time we are doing anything which we do right now is purely dependent on the context we are in and the environment we are in, right? We may have found memories of something which probably was great at that point of time, but then that was probably great at that point of time because of the great context or the different context which was there at that point of time. Context have changed, right? So I love to watch the time machine movies. They are good to have sci-fi movies, but to be honest, I am a strong believer that what we are doing right now should be what should be making the foundation and the base for the future. We do not want to bring anything from future, nor we want to, of course, take anything from the past. I think the present context is what defines us in terms of what we should do. We should focus on that, generate value in terms of whatever we do on a daily basis. Every day is a different day. Every day is a day which is probably the current day and probably also the day which was past and also the day which is going to come tomorrow. So day is different and there is nothing which probably we can keep as constant. So things are changing on a dramatic way, on a very fast accelerating way, almost on a daily basis. And it's very important that our strategies, our work, our vision, all that basically evolves, and then we don't need to have something from past or probably to bring something from future. We need to develop something right now which becomes the future, right? So that's what should be our focus.
Yes, sir. That sounds interesting. It's a well-known fact. Every day we fail, every day we pass.
Absolutely.
Let us continue, sir.
Sure.
In situations of disagreement between you and your team viewpoints, how do you react so as to make a balancing act?
Well, that's a very interesting question. So here is the take. Two people having the same opinion, working very, very closely, I believe one is redundant. So disagreements are actually very, very constructive, according to me. Disagreements basically helps in improving the situations. Many times when two people or more than two people are in a room and they are discussing some of the important design or some of the solutions, if everyone just agrees to each other, then the design will definitely not be a great design. So I think it's an opportunity that people disagree. They should disagree more often. They should disagree for a reason at the same time. There has to be a rationale for the disagreement. And obviously they should not disagree just for the sake of disagreeing, right? So there is nothing which needs to be dealt with in case of a disagreement. It is just that you have to understand the rationale behind the disagreement. You have to understand that how can you use that disagreement to generate more value in the idea or in the discussion which you are doing. And in the process, you will find that a final outcome of that discussion will be very beautiful. Most of the time, people do disagree for these reasons. Sometimes you will find that people are disagreeing for the sake of disagreement. I believe those have to be seen very, very cautiously, and one has to realize that that if there is no rationale of disagreement or agreement, then it does not make sense that that discussion goes on. And if it is leading to a destructive discussion, not a constructive discussion, then I think that discussion is definitely not the right discussion to have. But my experience have been that disagreements have most of the time adds to a lot of value, generates a lot of value, in fact, for whatever we discuss. So I praise every disagreement which happens. I encourage every opinion and every point which people have to make. It could be different than mine. I don't have to create my replicas in the organization. It is important that there are people who are different. They are diversified. They think diversified. They bring their viewpoints. And then all of us converge to something great, which eventually becomes greater satisfaction for the customer.
Indeed, sir. Disagreement is somewhat necessary for an effective decision making.
Absolutely.
Let's go ahead.
Sure.
When would and how would you make the decision to let a difficult employee go?
Difficult question. So, I guess no employee is a difficult employee, provided we start thinking in a very different way. So, for example, if we start using the words such as employee or employer, I think that creates more of a difference. Larger organizations, scalable organization, better organizations are built when everybody works unanimously for a common cause and everybody is being treated equally, right? So, irrespective of who is employing whom or who's being working as an employee, I think if we just get rid of these differentiations, suddenly everybody becomes more partnered, everybody becomes more cohesive, everybody becomes more thoughtful about the common cause which they want to achieve, right? So, but yes, we will have to highlight and sometimes distinguish some people. So we have terms such as employer, employee, corporates, business, and stuff like that. And obviously not everybody more or less have equal partnership in the organization. So sometimes these differences becomes wider and much more spoken, much more realized, much more felt. But I guess every employee has a great strength. Every individual has a great strength. Every person who is onboarded to the company comes because there are strengths which have been assessed, which have been evaluated by a set of people, starting from some roles to a different role. And most of the time, these evaluations are very thorough, right? In spite of that, there could be situations where there are lesser synergies between the person who has onboarded to the organizational vision, right? Sometimes we have different beliefs, sometimes we have different value systems, sometimes we have a different way of working or style of working or even different aspirations, right? So I think it's the differences which becomes larger and wider when these things are not being well addressed in the very beginning or well realized in the very beginning. Letting anyone go is always a painful aspect, actually. The fundamental thing is that why we have let somebody come in. So I think the stress should be more in terms of getting the right people who are probably more synergized to the organization vision, as against letting anyone come in and then later on letting people go. According to me, nobody is worthless, if I have to say so. Everybody has a worth, everybody has a talent, everybody has a skill, everybody has some unique thing in an individual. And it's only that sometimes if I'm functioning in a specific area and the person I have or somebody is coming in with an aspiration to work in some other function, then of course there are wider gaps, right? So my take is that it's difficult to let anyone leave. It's difficult to let anyone go, right? So the circumstances which we should create, the environment which we should create, the culture which we should create should be the culture wherein we are able to nurture people with diversified thoughts, with diversified thinking. That should be our goal, rather than finding easier ways or processizing that, okay, if I have to let somebody go, what process I will follow? I think it's very easy. Every organization have an exit procedure, and then what to do with the people who are not aligned, etc. I think the stress and focus should be less on that. The stress and focus should be more in terms of how do I make sure that I have a relevant talent which I am intaking, and how do I make sure that that talent is being nurtured and I'm able to utilize the strength he has or she has, or I'm able to convert the weaknesses of an individual and convert them to the strength over the period of time. Then I think it's more of a cohesive work, more of a collaborative work, more of something which everybody thinks that is of a value to each other, you know.
Yes, sir. It's always a difficult call for any employer.
True.
Moving forward to the next question.
Sure.
What are your views on work from home concept? Do you think it is an advantage or disadvantage in terms of the productivity of the employees?
Yeah, I think that's a hot question nowadays. So, especially due to the COVID situation. So, I think work from home was a concept which existed even before. It's just that it's coming into more limelight and getting more debated nowadays. Depending on the different type of industry, it's easy or moderate or difficult. So for example, IT industries, it's very easy because they have the technology to work from home and they can work from home in order to produce what they were producing earlier. But for the companies such as industries such as manufacturing, wherein you have to work, let's say, on the lathe machines or be on the floor, I think it's still a remote possibility in spite of the COVID situation. So their people have to be there in order to build or construct or manufacture something. You're building a building, suppose, right? So how will you build it remotely? You have to be there on the site to construct it. So for a certain industry, it makes a lot of sense, and it's working out pretty good. And I think organizations are also learning right now in order to define, redefine the workplace cultures, the way they can function, the way they can be productive. There are plenty of tools which were there are now getting a lot of attention. They are getting improved. And that really is helping, I will say, the whole industry, as well as, of course, the way people function using those tools. So, for example, if I'm working at my home and let's say I'm in some village, that's my hometown, and I do not have a nice background, I can probably use virtual backgrounds on tools such as WebEx or similar, so that others do not really worry about where I'm sitting and what's behind me, because what's behind me is a virtual background. It's not a real background. So and this is just a softer aspect where people really become conscious that can they take the calls or can they connect over the video conference, with the backgrounds they have, etc. But there are real issues as well which requires collaboration for people to work, and working virtually or remotely sometimes create difficulties for projects to collaborate well. But I think the world is a very small place. It's very well connected now, and the embracing of technology is actually helping us solve these problems. So I'll say organizations have learned big lessons at this point of time. They are feeling that work from home is more real, and actually it's not something which will take away the productivity or reduce the productivity to an extent that it start impacting the business. And they're also finding ways to improve and make sure that the productivity is at least the same as when people worked in office or even better. So over the period of time, I will say that it's a boon. It's in some sense a very useful stuff and will allow people to have more flexibility, greater flexibility in order to function and produce what they want to produce.
I completely agree to your point, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, now I would like to ask you, students are often confused that after completing their graduations like BBA, BCom, BCA, they should join a company to pursue a career or pursue higher education for future growth. Please highlight on these two aspects.
Okay, so I think we all know the importance of education in our life. It's the corporates or the organizations who have set the criteria that the entry point has to be, let's say, graduation, right? And then it depends also on the nature of the job and different types of functions for which organization really hires, wherein they define their criteria of that this job requires, let's say, post-graduation, or this job requires, let's say, doctorate, right? Or this job requires graduation. I believe graduation is a standard. Every organization more or less look for most of the roles, they look for obviously people who are graduate. But that does not, should limit, that should never limit the individual's aspiration to, of course, do more or learn more. I'm of the opinion that learning is a lifelong exercise. Learning is a lifetime opportunity. And at any point of time, whether somebody is employed or somebody is pursuing for the employment, or even somebody has done, achieved a milestone such as graduation, one should not leave the aspect of learning. And learning not necessarily has to happen from the colleges or the universities. Learning is a daily exercise, like what we are doing today. We are talking, but at the same time, I think we are learning from each other. So I think it's extremely important that people have always the aspiration to learn more. Many times it's the situation of a student which sometimes forces the person to actually get into the job immediately after the graduation. But I would rather recommend that even if such a situation arises, there is no harm in, of course, picking up the career, but the aspiration to learn more while being in career is also a great opportunity, right? There are a lot of people who continue their education even after they have joined somewhere. So there are two paths one can take. One can do the post-graduation in something which the person is passionate about, as well as, of course, in something which person wants to develop or build a career in, so that the person is more knowledgeable. An individual can do a survey in what kind of jobs basically require post-graduation and stuff like that. At the same time, one can also get into the job, one can also get into the career, but leaving the aspiration to study higher is, I will say, a crime. At any point of time, graduation should never be the last milestone of your qualification. Graduation should never be the end point of your qualification. Getting a job should never be the end of your learning experience. I think these are just milestones in the life. So I wish everybody keeps learning all the time through formal or informal ways. In informal ways, sometimes we don't even know we end up learning because of the behaviors of people around, because of the culture around and stuff like that. But I think in a formal education, it is very, very important that people keep learning throughout their career. People keep even learning after their career. So I have even gone much beyond, I will say. It's important to keep accruing some educational qualification which can generate value for you, which can generate value for your profession. Sometimes people limit themselves to, okay, I am into an industry, and this is the industry I need to probably excel, so I will learn only the area around that industry. I think the way people do investments, which are diversified, knowledge should also be like that. So people should learn diversified. People should have knowledge of various different things. So it's fine to even acquire a degree or a diploma of something which you think you love it, but it is not directly connected to your profession. So I will say we should constantly learn and evolve with the learnings.
As Steve Jobs has also said, learn continuously. There's always a one more thing to learn. Let's move on to the last question for the day. What's the success mantra you would like to share with our young graduates who are starting or shall start their career in this post-COVID era?
I guess the successes and failures are pretty much individual, and any specific rule which makes everybody succeed doesn't exist. So it has to be an individual effort, it has to be an individual commitment, it has to be individual aspiration, it has to be individual plans, and of course clear goals which one can individually have and aspire towards them probably will end up succeeding. One thing which people have to remember is it's not how much basically we are judged on you know how much we have risen, right? It's always the effort which counts, which basically starts from the roots to the ground level first. So if we are able to put that effort in the right direction, rising will happen, success will definitely follow. So no specific rule or a specific mantra for every individual to follow. But I believe if people have goals, if everyone has their aspirations to meet those goals, success is bound to come. dreaming about something which is big or small, it doesn't matter. I think it's important that we dream. It's important that we work towards a dream. And it's also important that we make that dream happen. And that can only happen by our commitment towards that dream. It's not others' wishes or what others think that dream is good or bad. It's eventually your dream. And if you're able to dream whatever you want to dream and you put your commitment towards it, that is bound to happen.
I'm mesmerized, and it was wonderful interacting with you, sir. This has been such a great experience, which is very difficult to put in words. I'm sure our audience watching us is equally impressed and have loads of learning come lessons to grasp and to adopt in their personalities in times ahead. Thank you so much once again for taking out time from your busy schedule. We look forward for many more interactions with you in future too. Please keep on guiding our young generation.
Thank you so much. It was a great learning experience for me as well.
So guys, hope you were thrilled, enjoyed and learned a lot from this episode. We simply had a blast and a great time today. We promise that we shall be back with another episode of Leadership Talks, where we shall be interacting with another leader from another sector. Till then, stay safe, stay healthy. Bye-bye.